Okay, morning. My name is Miguel Zuniga, and I'm gonna go over and talk about the, this talk is gonna be how we're basically gonna use the OpenStack components as microservices inside of containers. I'm gonna try to go a little bit slow. It's too early, and probably everybody's kind of like a hangover or something. This is the agenda that I'm gonna go through it. First of all, we're gonna just brief definition of microservices, why OpenStack, how we basically move OpenStack into microservices itself. Then we're just gonna see the standard architecture of OpenStack. After that, we're gonna go through why it's better to go over and do this on microservices instead of using DevStack for development. You'll see in a minute. After that, I'm gonna go over and show you how pretty much you build your code using the latest container. I mean, build your containers using the latest code so you can actually test from pretty much source and master or any release that you want. Then I'll show you real quick into how Docker file is written, what kind of a templates do we use, because we're basically using OpenShift and Kubernetes underneath. And then I'm gonna just give a really quick display on how pretty much Keystone shows up later. After that, we're just gonna go through some basic stuff, recommendations of how to run the OpenStack controllers and how do you pretty much roll updates, and at the end, just a general picture on how this stuff works. So let's start with the beginning. After that, we're gonna have Q&A if you guys want in there. So first of all, what is the microservices? This is pretty much from Wikipedia. And you can, and you've been hearing this a lot, and pretty much the only thing that it's saying is that you architect your application in a way that you go over and decouple it, and every single piece or every single group becomes a service group that they talk with each other within it. So you can have your application, if it is a billing or a whatever type of application, you can have like your billing system becomes one microservice, then your account management becomes another microservices, then you pretty much just split it apart. You grab those pieces that are really tight coupled, and those becomes just like a unit. So this time you're not looking into going over and figuring it out like where is X, Y, or Z piece into the code, or if you have a monolithic application, you usually start spreading apart, not as in, okay, I have my application server and my web server, pretty much as from function. So the whole idea of microservices is design the software in a way that will basically imitate or pretty much try to look how your business works. The same way that you, when your business is, you have different departments doing different things, that's the whole idea of kind of like a microservice. So after that, the other point of doing the microservices is that they're pretty much independent of each other, and they talk through APIs. They don't have to go over and say, oh, you know what, I need to do something with this other piece of code that is sitting on some other place, because you can just request it. So if the whole other piece of the code changes, as long as you have the API, you can still go over and use it. That's the whole point of using the microservices. So now, why are we doing it with OpenStack? Well, first of all, OpenStack is a huge ecosystem, multiple components, right? You have base core, and then you have a lot of different other components. Then the second one, every of these components is already called a service. So it's just like, okay, I mean, you have your compute service, you have your storage service, you have Keystone, you have Horizon. Each of them is actually doing a specific function, and they already talk each other using the APIs. It's not like you're gonna go over and use some crazy RPC call in the back, even though some part of OpenStack, they actually rely on RPC calls. But it's not as in you're having Keystone answering RPC calls from Nova. Usually it's just RPC calls within the same service itself. And last and for all, it's pretty much the components are independent from each other, except for the Keystone dependency that you basically use for authentication. Every other component doesn't matter if you have it or not. So that's the reason why we picked it up in OpenStack. Now, how you put it in, why move it as microservices? First of all, like I said, each component requires its own database. So it's not sharing anything. You can have your own separated database for each of the components. That basically allows you, I mean, it might indicate that you have to manage multiple databases instead of having just one huge server, but it also allows you to just decouple everything from, okay, now this is the section for Nova itself. So you can go over and deploy your own database inside of the Nova microservice without having to affect anybody else. Like I mentioned before, they interact with APIs. So it doesn't matter what exactly happens in the OpenStack code in the back. As long as you're using the API, it will basically go over and still work. That's one of the reasons why OpenStack pretty much allows some type of upgrades without much of a problem. Usually when you try to upgrade OpenStack, aside of going over and saying, I need to modify the schema in the database, every other thing is pretty much straightforward. Second one is pretty much the architecture of Share Nothing. It's pretty much completely independent, and it's not gonna be going over and relying on something that you have to be seen by multiple servers at the same time. Then it's designed from scratch since day one, even when it was, Cactus? They already start looking to microservices themselves. So it's already built in. And the last for it is if once you create your microservice inside of your container, you can easily go over and deploy it right away and give the developers the ability to deploy as easy as just like one-click deployments. So moving forward here, this is the standard architecture of OpenStack. That's how pretty much everybody sees it, and that's from like OpenStack docs of OpenStack.org. But as you can see, it's already telling you right there that it's pretty much different services connecting through the API. So the whole reason was, I mean, if it is already sitting in that point, why not use something that is already built for microservices? That's the reason we decided to go and start doing Kubernetes and OpenShift. Kubernetes is pretty much designed for doing microservices. Gives you everything that you require, like a load balancer, replication, scalability, at the microservice level. Now, I'm not saying about the Kubernetes cluster or anything like that. Pretty much it's at the microservice. So when you go over and have your pretty much deployment inside of Kubernetes, you can go over and define services. Each service becomes like the network service or the compute service or the image service. Within those image services, they're running your containers of those OpenStack components only. So you can pretty much decouple everything. Now, having containers is really easy to go over and say, okay, we need to start testing something else. Or you need to go over and give it a new environment to somebody so it can actually test something. So it's really way much simpler than going over and doing a whole OpenStack deployment into, okay, this is our dev environment, then this is our test environment, and this is our production environment. So moving forward, that's the reason why we started with DevStack and moving this stuff into it. One of the problems with DevStack that everybody knows and everybody goes over and code is that it's a mess. I mean, it's really a mess. You go over, you just run some script that basically does everything in the back for you, and you have no idea what's going on. So a lot of the problems when you are coding pretty much goes into, okay, what exactly is doing here? If you're coding some specific section, just like a Python module or something like that, that's fine. But if you're actually trying to code something a little bit bigger, it's way much more difficult to go in there. I have no idea how like developers actually deal with it right now, because you go and try to figure out that I'm gonna, I don't know, put a Nova API version 3. And how do you test against everything else? It's like you have to know like what exactly Keystone is doing, what exactly Nova is doing, if Nova is going to talk to Neutron. So the problem with DevStack from the point of view is that you don't see the actual thing running. You just see a bunch of things that are happening, and you have no idea what it is. However, once we decided to go and start moving to microservices, that thing changes. Because now you have every single of those components, even calling it from master, which basically is what DevStack does, starts downloading everything from master and then set it up for you. But this time you're pretty much separating in small Docker containers. And you can actually see the whole system working without having to go over and do some craziness into it or nothing like that. It's just like really straightforward. You create the Docker container, build it, and then you go over and deploy it in pretty much just pushing the JSON template to OpenShift or to Kubernetes. Pretty much the same thing. And now, when you're actually coding, you can see the difference, because you can go over and see, okay, I have the RabbitMQ service here, I have the database service here, and I have the other microservices sitting around it. You can actually see what is gonna be the relationship between each other, and will give you a better idea on what exactly you need to go over and figure out when you're trying to debug something. So, Once we have the, once we actually move through this, is how you build OpenStack containers using the latest code. Well, pretty much that's one of the benefits of Docker. And that's the reason why we decided to containerize this stuff. Because you can go over and you don't have to be running any specific RPM distribution. You can go over and install the RPM distribution if you want. But you can also go over and just create, grab a Docker container, log in there and pull down the source code and do just the pip install requirements and then pip setup build, and that's pretty much it. We'll go over and deploy everything for you. Now, how you go over and pass over the like parameters and all that kind of stuff, I'll go through it in a minute. But in doing this stuff in microservices is way easier because you will be able to put it on the CI pipeline, straightforward. So every single time somebody makes a new commit, they rebuild. Right now, that's pretty much what they are doing in Symantec. The OpenStack team basically pushes something in there, and some of the actual scripts on the CI pipeline will build the Docker container or will build RPMs, depending on what we basically want to go and put in there. Then it's easy to deploy through the CI pipeline. The thing with Kubernetes is that once you create your template for Kubernetes for each of these OpenStack components, it's just a matter of handing over that template to another developer, and that's it. He doesn't have to write it again. He doesn't have to modify it. It's straightforward. Just pass it over. He'll initiate the pretty much OpenShift Kubernetes deployment, and probably in a few seconds, he'll have his own version or his own environment for the OpenStack components. Second one is the pretty much you can use the same container over and over and over. Once you jump into container side, some people will go over and say, well, it's pretty much the same way as doing packages, kinda. The only thing is that it's way easier than doing over a Debian file or doing over an RPM file. Here is just like the same instructions that you have in OpenStack on how to download and contribute. Just go into the container, build it up, and there you go. After you build the container, you just pretty much tag it into which environment do you want. So you can tag it as development, you can tag it as my version one, my testing version two, or whatever it is. Once you test it over, you just pretty much change the tag or tag the container again, or actually the image of the container, and we'll go over and say, okay, now it's ready for production. At that point, Kubernetes can and OpenShift can go over and say, okay, I have a new tag that is ready for production. I'm going to start rolling it out. So it pretty much moves the same way, and you can actually align it to the releases of OpenStack. And last for all, once you have it inside or on your CI pipeline, pretty much it's really straightforward to build a container. So I'm going to give some examples here. Okay, I still have time. Some examples of what is it that is happening here. So to build the Docker files, there's something that you have to go through here. Sometimes you go and say, okay, I'm just going to go into Docker Hub, download what is up there. The fact that it's in Docker Hub and it is actually a container doesn't mean that we'll run on Kubernetes. That's one of the problems that we went through. Because Kubernetes has a different way of using Docker, which is pretty much it's similar, but relies on some other components, like using environmental variables to pass something into the container. So if you go over and just pull down whatever you have from like OpenStack in Docker Hub, it might run on your VM, but that doesn't mean that we'll be able to go over and put in there. Same reason why we try to go over and build it ourselves. That way we build the containers ourselves, we basically move it over to fit the actual Kubernetes cluster, and we can go ahead and move forward with it. The other thing is that now that you're basically inside of this stuff, Docker allows you to pass over multiple environmental variables, multiple scripts and everything. But how an easy way to go and set it up is that you create three scripts, the installation script, then the configuration script, and then the startup script. Pretty much our only wrappers around the actual instructions. So on the configuration script, you just put it on that, okay, I'm gonna download git clone from OpenStack, everything is in there. Once you have all your dependencies, you call the installation script. Do Python setup.py, there you go. And on the run script, which is the actual script that runs Docker, is where you start the actual service for OpenStack, passing all the environmental variables. So with that in mind, this is a small example. Can you guys see it? Let me see. I'm not even sure if I'm going to be able to increase it or not. Hold on. Let me just put it here. put it up. Oh, it's not showing. Okay, there we go. There we go. So this is just one of the examples. Like you see, we're basically going over and saying from CentOS, we're using CentOS 7 as the base container. Then we just put the maintainer. And then we start defining the environmental variables that we're going to pass over to the configuration script. Why we do this is because when you drop this stuff into Kubernetes, the only way of setting it up your container or actually telling it you have to do this stuff is either you can grab something from outside, let's say tell the container download first the configuration file from somewhere, or pretty much here are all the environmental variables that I'm passing you, configure your configuration file automatically before it actually runs. So that's the reason why we have so many environmental variables. But like I said, there's multiple ways of doing this. Then we pretty much just grab the installation script for Horizon. That's the one that actually contains all the Git clone and pretty much pulling every single thing from our Git repository. Then we have the configuration script and the startup script. So as you can see, when we build the image itself, the one that we're running in this section that is going down here that says run, install Horizon, all that kind of stuff. That's what it gets executed when you're building the image and when you're doing the Docker build. So by the end of that one, you already have a container image with Horizon installed. When we actually pass over the startup.sh, it's really more into, okay, just call this stuff. It's going to start Apache for us, passing all the environmental variables at that point. So these are really one of the examples, but all of the others is pretty much straightforward. You just define all the environmental variables that you have in there. You can put up your installation script, your configuration script, and then the one that actually calls the service. I'm gonna go over through the next one, which is, let me just put it up here. Here it is. So, okay, before we move into that one, another of the things here is that another of the benefits is that, for instance, how do you deal with services that pretty much are running multiple things, like Nova? You have Nova proxy, you have Nova API, you have Nova conductor, and you have the scheduler. What we did in that case is that we basically installed Nova, and on the startup script, we just pass over the environmental variable of the service itself. So the startup script reads, for instance, when we do a Docker run manually, we do Docker run, OpenStack, Nova, and then we pass over API, and then all your environmental variables. That pretty much allows you to have only one image that can spin up all the services from Nova itself. Depending on which environmental variable you pass over, you can actually go over and start, this time I'm gonna put up Nova proxy, or this time I'm gonna start up conductor, or this time I'm gonna just put up Nova itself, Nova API. So that's one of the other benefits, that you can have everything in there and you don't have to rework your stuff in order to be able to spin up multiple services within the same, within the Docker and the container ecosystem. So once we have our containers itself, we're gonna go and I'm gonna show you a little bit of a file. There we go. So this is the actual OpenShift Kubernetes, hold on, let me just put zoom in. No, not that big. This is the actual Kubernetes OpenShift template that we use for Keystone. As you can see here, we have the deployment configuration, which basically goes over and tells, okay, you know what, we're gonna have a trigger every single time an image change. And we basically just pass the URL of the image in there, so automatically gets in there. We specify the number of replicas of Keystone that we're gonna be running. So since it's inside of the Kubernetes world, each container becomes a pod itself. So you can go over and have your container, actually a pod that is sitting with the MySQL database, and a separate pod that is going over and sitting with the actual Keystone service. The thing that allows you this time is that the MySQL might not be able to scale because you have to do some magic tricks in there, right? But in Keystone API, you can pretty much just go over and tell it, instead of one replica here, 130. And Kubernetes automatically goes over and scales Keystone on the fly. since it's already a microservice itself and it's only running as a Docker container, it's pretty much just going over and grabbing the Docker container and saying, there you go, started. So here is pretty much where we go and tell it. We're basically running one Keystone, the Keystone container itself. We're putting the product, the ports that we were basically using for the admin and the standard port. Well, not standard port, but anyway. And then we pass over all these environmental variables that I was mentioning at the beginning. That at the moment that the Keystone container starts and Kubernetes passes over these environmental variables, it will go over and automatically configure the keystone.conf and let it actually run with whatever settings that you want. So the developers can actually go and change the stuff on the fly without having to, like, where it's running or in which server I have to jump into it. They basically just go into the actual Kubernetes cluster itself and just redeploy really straightforward with whatever they want to go and put. So this is just one, another example. The file is kind of long because we pass a lot of the things in there, but we're passing every single piece that requires in order to authenticate, I mean, in order to start the thing. Then after that, we go over and tell it, okay, we're gonna create the routes. Pretty much a route allows the external services that are not within the Kubernetes OpenShift cluster to access it. So for instance, if you have a client, if you wanna try it out with the Keystone client, you create the route, automatically Kubernetes goes over and says, okay, this route that is gonna hit this specific service that you have here, will go over and tell it, send it over directly to the container. They don't have to worry about anything else. It's just like going through the actual load balancer, hitting the actual system that you have in the back. Then we have another separated, there is a second route because since we have two ports, we're basically load balancing the traffic between each of the like replicas for those specific ports. And it's pretty much the same way. It's just like we're gonna create another external access to go over and hit this service. Once you define that one, you pretty much define here exactly what is gonna be the service itself. So you just go over and call it Keystone A or Keystone B or Keystone whatever, specify which is gonna be the port that you're gonna be going over and using at that point. And then you can tell it over with the selector to which actual container are gonna be running. So moving forward, here's the other example of the second Keystone stuff. And then we have the parameter sections where we basically is just input field that OpenShift creates where the developers go over and just like start typing down the parameters that you want. And everything that you have here will basically be passed over to the actual container when it starts. So like I said, it's a little bit big, long because it has a lot of different things that we're basically passing over. But the whole point of this that I wanted to show is that once you have it this one, you just pass over the file and that's it. Or you just pretty much enable OpenShift to go over and say, I'm gonna share this template with somebody else. And you just share the template across all your users or to a specific user. They don't have to go over and do the rework or anything else. So anybody that wants to go and deploy Keystone, it's just either UI, one click and go over and put it, or just grab this file and upload it to his own account in Kubernetes, and that's pretty much straightforward. So that being said, let me just go back to the presentation here really quick. This is how pretty much looks once we deploy it. So as you can see, there's already in there. That's one of the services that we're basically specifying in there. The other one is the second service. Each of them are basically going over and have their specific ports. And the coolest thing here is that within the Kubernetes cluster itself, if you wanna go over and hit Keystone from another container, let's say that Nova is gonna hit Keystone, you don't have to learn the actual URL that you're using. You just pretty much tell it the name of the service that you specify. So if I'm inside of another container and I wanna hit the Keystone API, I just have to go over and like ping OpenStack Keystone-A. And that basically Kubernetes resolves automatically to the node that you're actually running that specific container and passes over all the traffic into it. So you don't have to worry about like, oh, what's the URL now? Or what's the IP now? It doesn't matter at all. It doesn't matter if you just pretty much scale it down to zero and bring it back. Pretty much the whole deal is that Kubernetes knows where it's like every single other microservice, so it's able to route everything through it, which allows us to pretty much do like really quick deployments. So And this is just, like I said, this is pretty much just the kind of like the UI part of that we have in there. Once if the like another of the developers wants to go over and add, for instance, Nova, or he wants to go over and do something with Nova or test something with Nova, it's just a matter of clicking on the add the project. They select the Nova template and pretty much goes over and gets deployed. So now that we have that one in there, I'm gonna go through really quick into how we basically got there. So we created, like I said, one image per service. We have one image for Keystone, one Docker image for Keystone, one for Nova, one for Glance, one for Horizon, and one for Cinder. Then we push the images into our registry that we have internally. We basically create the template only once. And once we have the template, we can basically start sharing it up. Then Kubernetes takes the template and starts deploying the microservices anywhere where you want. Doesn't matter if you want to go and have your own dev, test, and prod, the user just gets in there, creates a dev project, deploys the things into it, creates another project in Kubernetes, and goes over and deploy the things again, and then creates another project and deploy the things again. But it's pretty much its own environment. So you don't have to be fighting around resources or like who broke something or something like that. You know, it's pretty much really straightforward. Then after that, we have test, and try to test. And then you just promote it to the next environment. How the promotion gets done, like I said, with Docker tags. We can go over and say, I'll show you pretty much the pipeline, how it runs in a minute, or actually the diagram at the end. But you'll be able to see that it's pretty much up to whether you want to use the releases of OpenStack, and every single time you commit something, gets a new image built, or you pretty much go over and run every single time you run a Jenkins job, for instance, or every single time you create a new Docker image. Straightforward. Pretty much OpenShift and Kubernetes, they can go over and execute the redeployment on any of those triggers or scenarios. So now that we have everything there up and running, and let me see what time is it. Okay, still have time. Now that we have everything up and running, allows us to pretty much simplify not only that section, but also part of the operations. Because deploying an application within Kubernetes, like I mentioned before, is just a matter of creating a new image. Kubernetes has multiple ways of deploying. You can go over and recreate everything, or you can do rolling updates, where basically it's gonna go over and start replacing each of the containers that it has, or each of the pods, until it gets to the actual version that you require on that specific Docker image. So moving forward on the rolling updates, like I said, the way that pretty much set up is that a new image gets created, you deploy on the test project, you tested it out, then you tag it as production or any other flag that you want to put it in place, and then pretty much automatically Kubernetes gets redeployed. There's a little bit of, sometimes there's a little bit of a downtime, but it really depends on like how fast Kubernetes actually spinning up the container, which to be honest is really fast. Because usually Kubernetes goes over and tries to prefetch the image, and then it'll go over and actually start the container itself before killing the previous one. So one of the things is that the two nodes that I put in there, the upgrades means that you're actually upgrading the application. The SQL schema, and that's something that we pretty much at Symantec we went through it, when we were moving from, what was it, Ice House to Kilo? I think it was from Ice House to Kilo. We had to pretty much go over and build a separate OpenStack control plane to be able to move all the VMs first through the load balancer and pretty much build a separate control plane because we were basically moving forward from Ice House to Kilo, right? So we upgraded everything and on a new pretty much control plane. And then the previous one, we just moved all the IPs, or all the pretty much all the beeps to point to that one, and then we destroy the second one. But doing the actual schema upgrade, that's a whole different story. So this is pretty much allows you to move forward really fast, but as long as, like I said, you don't have to do much of a database schema. You can still go over and tell it, you know what, Kubernetes, when you're actually gonna go over and deploy something, execute a job. Kubernetes is also trying to hit the same way that it's kind of like trying to hit the job scheduler part. Mesos is really good at this stuff, but Kubernetes just started to add those specific sections. So for those only instances where you have to upgrade a schema or pretty much fail over something or all that kind of stuff that is only once, you can define a specific update job where you actually pass over the command that you're going to be executing against some of the containers or a specific pod, and that will basically get in there, execute it. Using Docker exec and everything, it will execute it itself, and then it will tell you, okay, I'm done. Then you can actually move forward with the actual deployment. And the other thing is that depending on how you have it set it up, like I mentioned, you can go over and auto-deploy, or you can pretty much wait until, okay, I'm going to sit down here and go over and click the button myself. So it's pretty much, depending on how you set up the deployment configuration, it's you will basically go and do one or the other. So at the end, this is pretty much the OpenStack architecture that we have. The pretty much developer goes over and starts coding something. That one pretty much, we have three options. We basically set up the Git repo webhook that basically every single time a new commit is in there, it's actually merged. It will go and tell OpenShift and Kubernetes there's a new version of the code. OpenShift has a thing called source to image that pretty much takes care of grabbing the code directly from Git, building the image for you, and then having it stored locally in there so you can actually go over and redeploy it. So if you really want something that is completely automated, you put out the Git rip and the Git webhook. As soon as they put merge, works like a GitHub webhook, pretty much the same deal. Git tells OpenShift new commit is in there in place, and OpenShift basically pulls down the latest code, actually pulls down that specific commit up to that commit, and starts building the image for you. And then it will allow you to say, okay, I'm going to deploy it or not redeploy it, depending on how you have the configuration triggers in your application. The second one is that we can go over and deploy things using the CI pipeline. The same way that GitHub on the Git webhook works, there's a JSON webhook that you can pass over to anything. As long as you just do a curl to hit the specific application that Kubernetes is giving you, it will basically go over and do the same thing. I'm pulling down the new image. I'm pulling down the new source, build the image itself, and there we go. Or you can pretty much move it over until your Docker image, after the CI pipeline is done, you can build the image itself there, and you can go over and push it over into your registry. At that moment, same way, OpenShift Kubernetes is basically querying your registry for all the images that you're using inside of the Kubernetes cluster. So pretty much it will go over and say, okay, I have a new tag on this specific image that just came out, and I don't have that MDI5 hash. So I'm just gonna pull it over into my internal registry, and then I'm gonna go ahead and deploy it automatically. Like I said, the triggers depends on when you're building and where you're gonna go over and deploy. If you go over and tell it, as soon as a new image is in there, go over and deploy it, new image gets in place, and hit it's in there. And then after that, you'll see that this is pretty much a small diagram of the architecture that is how it's pretty much running. The service that we have here is, like I mentioned, the piece of the load balancer that takes care of it, that is managed by Kubernetes. And then you have the pod, which is the actual database. Inside of that database is just a small container for the specific, it's a small container having the MySQL instance, where pretty much Keystone and all the other components drop their pieces in there. So if for some reason Keystone goes down, it takes its own database and it's not gonna affect anybody else. It's not something that you have to worry about, okay. I mean, you still have to worry, like if you wanna put a Galera cluster in the back or something in there, but it's not something that will basically impact everything. And that's one of the key, that's one of the purpose of microservices. If you lose that specific microservice, it won't impact the others because it's pretty much not, you are not sharing any of the components. And the whole piece in the middle is pretty much just the Kubernetes network that they basically go out and allow the other components to just go and say, I need to talk to Nova. I'm just gonna go over and use the name of the service of Nova to talk to it directly. I don't have to worry about IPs or anything else. And pretty much that's the whole reason why we decided to go over and start testing this out, moving forward into it. And right now, like I mentioned, we already have the pieces for Nova, Keystone, Horizon, Celometer, Glance, Congress, and I don't remember which one is working right now, which other one they're building. But anyway, pretty much they allow them to go over and say, right, they're doing right now the testing of what is better, using Keystone with Apache or Keystone with Eventlet. So in order to test it out, simple, just go over and deploy the actual JSON template from Keystone Apache, the other one of JSON, of Eventlet, and you just pretty much benchmark it. Straightforward. You don't have to go over and tell, okay, I'm going to reconfigure everything in there or put up an RBM or something like that, because it doesn't even matter for from the infrastructure point anymore. And with that said, I'm not even sure if I still have like 5 minutes. Okay, I'm going to leave pieces to questions and answers. Any questions? Oh, there are questions. Wasn't expecting.
Since you put OpenShift along with Kubernetes, do we need both or either or it is?
No, OpenShift is basically Kubernetes with an extra extension that Red Hat built for it, which provides like user management, security context, the deployment section, but pretty much it's Kubernetes.
So to start using this, you need first OpenShift to be installed, right? Before mm-hmm. we can do anything.
Yeah.
Based on what you have given.
Yeah, so the thing is that pretty much this is almost like, this is pretty much running OpenStack on top of Kubernetes or on top of OpenShift, whichever way you want to call it. But that's the whole thing. A lot of the times here you go over and say, okay, I'm going to deploy my control plane and I have to go over and build VMs and I have to go over and provision the VMs and just like configure everything and replication and the load balancer and all that kind of stuff. We're pretty much letting Kubernetes take care of that for us. Since when you create the Kubernetes cluster, you pretty much allocate nodes at the beginning and just install Kubernetes. Doesn't matter what you're actually deploying inside of it, it will basically just load balance across all those nodes, move them around, and pretty much take care of all the other like infrastructure pieces for you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? No? Awesome. Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate your time and getting up early.